seems that the Second World War, the Holocaust, proceeded in the worldwide depression of 1930s. European democracies fell and were replaced with authoritarian regimes as a part of the elements. Last year, the British government issued a report that concluded that environmental devastation from global warming could result in a 5 to 20% decrease in the world's economic production, which would be comparable to the Great Depression and World War Wars. Unfortunately, global warming could result in hunger, diminished agricultural production, and fisheries, water shortages, epidemics, the coastal flooding that could displace as many as 200 million people. Other experts argued that the report's conclusions were understated. But what is our world order? Are we ready for the world we can face if we force conclusions to incorrect? Will environmental and economic devastation result in failed states, authoritarian regimes, the spread of extremism and terror, and warfare on our shores by being scarce resources? Our national security officials won't like surprises. But they make it their business to anticipate events and plan for different contingencies, however they like it. In the 40s and the 50s, we were frequently surprised when governments we thought were stable failed to coups or revolutions. Our intelligence communities develop models for the quest of societies that are unstable or might become unstable. And contingency planning is second nature, in relation to a military coup, adversaries apply to counter the advance that the military plans on. Have we considered which societies may become enlightened as a result of environmental the possibility of the world transformed by climate change is not a science fiction image of a post-apocalyptic society where it is not a world war in America. It is happening now. There is another Holocaust now in our form. The barbaric Bashir regime certainly is responsible for the genocide in our form. But the UN General Secretary of Ban Ki-moon recently called the Darfur conflict an ecological crisis that underlies the least impact from climate change. Arab tribes and African tribes lived together more or less in harmony for centuries, maybe millennia. The precipitation levels already in the Arab region has declined by 40% in the last 2 decades. As the Sahara moves south, and what it does in sub-Saharan Africa. But there is no longer enough water. For African farmers. The findings of the Sudan has resulted in 400,000 to 450,000 deaths, 2.5 million people who are living in refugee camps, and 4 million people who are about half the region's population depend on food assistance to survive. Can we struggle in governments in developing nations with science from the economic consequences of global warming? Will those ungoverned regions become preconditions for extremism and terrorism? The consequences of global warming affect the work of many communities of these powers. There is something about the subject of the UN's on science and technology today. The national security implications of global warming certainly may guide the work of this committee. What research should we be doing that we're not doing already? What research should we be doing in priority? Of security concerns. Can we be better prepared to protect our national security interests by conducting research that will predict what consequences can come from global warming and when? Can we be better prepared by conducting research into how to mitigate the consequences of global warming because the consequences are so dire, whether or not we are certain they will happen? To give just one example of the things that this committee faces, this committee fought for years to position to eliminate sensors designed to collect climate data from the in-place satellites, the National Climate Orbiting Operation Environmental Satellite System. The Department of Defense decided to eliminate the sensors to save money and what was already embarrassingly large, trusted bombs. But there was the elimination of those sensors, short-sighted, just on the basis of national security concerns and our national security needs. Each veteran's day, Professor of Data Strategy has been examining the current thinking of the nature of management and the threats that global warming represent to national security. I have experience with this issue. This April, I participated in hearing on exactly the same topic before the Select Committee on Energy and Dependence of Global Warming. The issue was not new to me, but as chair of the Science Committee, I had more experience on that topic. What I've shared with my hearings is evidence that I believe it is important, but increasingly discussions about climate change are dominated by lobbies in the state of common sense. As global warming has become more and more popular politically, predictions of the Earth's future have become more and more accurate. And images of a worldly degree warmer sun are almost post-apocalyptic. For some of the scenarios I've told you are destined to face in front, increased border and immigration stress on the United States from Mexico to the Caribbean, a widening wealth gap and intellectual and financial dealing within developing countries, increased poverty, floods, monsoons, mountain glaciers, tropical cyclones, hurricanes, water contamination, ecosystem destruction, and political unrest throughout the years ago, even a full-scale war between China and Russia. Education and understanding of the effects of global warming are critical, but sermons about an environmental apocalypse, while effective in rallying political support, ultimately might not fail, forcing a poor prioritization of resources and threatening our ability to respond to more imminent threats. The national security risk posed by climate change need to be balanced against other threats and priorities. Climate change and its effect on national security have not exactly been ignored. As I have mentioned, the Select Committee has already held an identical hearing. There have been a slew of books and policy papers, several of which will be discussed today. And most importantly, the intelligence community has already studied the issue. The Office of the Director of National Intelligence informed me that it expects to release a DNI-DNA shooting in 2008. Nonetheless, both the Senate and the House are considering legislation that would force the DNI to submit DNI. And his office is already working on holding identical hearings and mandating reports that are already being recognized more to do with politics than preparedness. This is not the first time someone has claimed the sky is falling. The predictions surrounding Y2K were similarly done. Of course, this time it's different. Every time the sky falls, it's different. And every time those who advocate common sense or chastise for ignoring the inescapable power. Maybe it's my unswerving optimism that protects me from paranoia. Or maybe it's just a lifetime of experience with dire prognostications. As otherwise as it would be for us to ignore the national security implications of climate change, it is equally unwise to politicize our security to a degree that we exaggerate certain threats and ignore others. Environmental consequences are not the only problems we have to address in response to global warming. The other side of this challenge is that politicians and green extremists are reluctant to acknowledge is that our energy demands are rising and will continue to rise. Running out of conventional power plants is a real threat. We need to find solutions like nuclear power that limit carbon emissions, but also ensure that our energy needs will be met. We are also facing unprecedented economic challenges, as the challenges of competing in a globalized economy among rapidly growing countries like China and India have made it clear again and again that they do not intend to hinder their economic growth to curb climate change. This means that any modest successes we enjoy in limiting our emissions will be completely offset by China and other nations. It also means that we cannot afford to stall our own economic development when other nations will not be similarly handicapped. Solutions that compromise our ability to produce energy and compete with global economy will be disastrous for America's future. Bolstering a more robust economy is our strongest defense against climate change. As the New York Times published an article called Feel Good versus Do Good on Climate, the weather matters a lot less now than how people respond to it. According to the article, Robert Davis, the climatologist at the University of Virginia, concluded that the number of heat-related deaths in New York in the 1990s was 33% lower than in the 60s. It was not, of course, cooler in the 90s than it was in the 60s, but an increase in air conditioning saved lives. Because it is too late to prevent rising temperatures, the best response is to ensure our economy is strong enough to adequately respond. Everyone agrees that the wealthy circumstances affect the overall picture of our national security. There are other risk solutions to global warming and the multitude of problems that it prevents will be solved by the scientific community and emerging technological industries. As policymakers, our focus should be on encouraging these industries, ensuring that our energy is being driven by resources avoiding carbon emissions, and by responding to an anticipated problem generated by climate change. Thank you.
Thank you, other members. May I submit written testimony for the record? Strategic analysis to use in terms of potential foreign policy and national security implications of global climate change. The AOC will certainly take a testimony, or testimony is only 5 minutes. I think you can do all of this in a written testimony, which is longer than that. If you practice in something, you take testimony in your own community, or an investigation community, it's not truly an investigation. Since we're asking you to speculate about the future, it's pretty hard to imagine the capacity of the project. If your forecast proved to be incorrect, but either do you have any objection to being sworn in? We don't prefer that you tell us the truth, federal constitutions appear on the record. And you have the right to be represented by counsel. Do you have counsel with you today? Please stand and raise your right hand. You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth. Thank you. John Sullivan, you may be here. I'm Mr. Chairman of the membership committee. I'm here as the chairman of the Military Advisory Board of the CIA Corporation. The advisory board consists of retired 3- and 4-star flag officers from the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines. We were charged with looking at the emerging phenomenon known as global climate change through the prism of our own experience, and specifically looking at the national security implications for global climate change. Except this, I must admit I can't be the advisory board as a skeptic. There's lots, and I'm not sure, some of the others didn't as well. There's lots of conflicting information on the subject of climate change, and like most public policy issues in America, many opinions on the specific issue. After we listen to leaders of the scientific business and governmental communities, both I and my colleagues came to agree that global climate change is and will be a significant threat to our national security. The potential destabilizing impacts of global climate change include reduced access to fresh water and pure food production, health issues, especially from vector and foodborne diseases, and land loss, flooding, and so forth, and the displacement of major populations. And phenomena is related to failed states, growth of terrorism, mass migrations, and greater regional and inter-regional instability. The findings of the board are first, projected climate change poses a serious threat to America's national security. Potential threats to national security require careful study and prudent planning. Second, climate change impacts as a threat multiplier for instability in some of the most volatile regions in the world. Projected climate change will add to tensions even in stable fourth, climate change, national security, and energy dependence are related set of global challenges. The recommendations of the board are that we cannot wait for certainty in this issue, and as has been pointed out here in the two statements this morning. There is a lack of certainty, but there is certainly no lack of challenges. In our view, failing to act because of warning isn't precise would be imprudent. Second, the United States should commit to a stronger national and international role to help stabilize climate change at levels which will avoid significant disruption to global stability and security. And we should commit to global partnerships to work in that regard. And I believe there have been a number of activities this week which support that. Fourth, the Department of Defense, which it's doing, should enhance its operational capabilities by accelerating the adoption of improved business processes and innovative technologies. And fifth, DOD should conduct an assessment of the impact on military installations worldwide of the rise of sea level, extreme weather events, and other possible climate change impacts over the next 30 to 40 years. Climate change, national security, energy dependence on oil and the related. Simply not given these relationships will remain static. It's simply not acceptable given our training and experience as military leaders. And hoping that everything's going to be great probably won't work, at least in our view. In closing, I would say that most of us on the advisory board were in the military service of the United States of America for over 30 years, most of the time. High levels of catastrophe would have, could have taken place and what might have taken place if we didn't invest in military preparedness and awareness of the threats we face. In my view, there is uncertainty here, and it would be prudent for us to pay attention and to do our best to understand what is really going on so that we can respond if asked. And I request my full statement and add it to the report. And I stand ready to answer your questions. Thank you, Larry. It will, of course, be added. Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's an honor to be asked to appear before you today and to appear beside Frank and myself. I would stress I'm speaking only for myself and not for the institution that I'm associated with. I've attached a 24-page draft of my chapter, which you referred to in my chapter that introduced me earlier. I'd like to use these 5 minutes to point out several things in that chapter. I deal now with two types of risks to our future. I call them malignant disruptions. By malignant, I mean something that my cancer in the human body is not intentionally caused. industries as well. I think we're missing strong now, but there does a lot of growth in the philosophical things that are practical things. So, I think we all know that America's standing in many parts of the world is not what we'd like to have it be. I look back at when the earthquake and tsunami hit in Southeast Asia, the fact that we had military assets available ended up being a lifesaver in Indonesia. And that one of the countries where our poor really is but even people who might have been Islamic fundamentalists who hate the values that we stand for recognize that we saved a lot of lives, and we also saved a lot of suffering and people whose lives were now in jeopardy. How do you, each of you, think that we ought to be looking at an intelligence estimate in terms of not necessarily dealing toward a catastrophic event which may or may not have been caused by a climate, but essentially building up goodwill that we are on their side in things like providing agricultural self-sufficiency, which we have done very well since the end of the Second World War, encouraging reforestation, which everybody agrees on solving carbon, reversing the looting of the rainforest in certain parts of Africa and South America and other parts of the world. How does intelligence and strategic planning fit into that? I think very closely, if you look at East Africa, there is migration from north to south, out of Somalia into Kenya, and nations south. Problem is, well, not the problem, but they're seeking food. They're seeking, in some cases, fish. The Wildlife Federation is a program to assist countries in East Africa. They have Coast Guards, interestingly enough, with relatively small boats, people in those countries are able to go out to patrol their own shores, which in fact limits overfishing. I think there are many things that you point out which can be done, and I think commands like Africa under General Kip Ward and his people, they're looking at those issues, deforestation, economic self-sufficiency, agricultural self-sufficiency, and they have done pretty good examples of how reforestating in such a world, helps. And I think those are simple things which can be done and will be done. I'm reasonably sure they will be done.
Can I try an American face on that?
How do you put it?
I didn't put an American face on that.
But I think, I don't know this for sure, but I think the special forces and some of the military missions which are going on in parts of Africa do have an American face.
I think that in short, the sort of best of the churches I have come to earlier, in modest amounts of climate change, particularly warming in the southern hemisphere, let's say here, it's likely to have enough water change associated with climate changes and freshwater changes that we're going to start to see very substantial beginnings of migrations. And
we tend to focus on climate change.
Transporting petroleum products or energy or even along pipelines or on transmission lines creates
it's a system that is not able to handle the most rural landfill. The surgery group without mechanics will block the pipeline and lock down the transmission line on the outside. And your loving solution, I don't probably know, has some very important work on basic security applications of dispersed energy versus local energy, soft energy plants. My understanding is he's gotten scant attention. He's tried to get attention from our planners in Iraq, but I would certainly think we ought to spend a full month like that talking to Henry, listening to Henry Lovins, and implementing some of his recommendations in Iraq rather than trying to secure these pipelines at the highest pipelines.
I think the only thing we're going to do, but
trying to prevent a cycle of neighborhood of climate. But by the way, it's not only for us as impact at the same time, what are that potential? But what do you agree with that? Okay. How do I agree with that? I mean, I think there's some things that we can hide in, and there's some things we can do to mitigate. But I'm not going to reverse. We're doing our job on the reverse. Should we reverse cancer? Or we reverse the ozone by limiting air spray along with the ship free on it? That's another issue that I'm not saying so much today. But in terms of actually reversing the climate change that we're working on, by changing human activity, is a lot different than saying, which was Mr. Rosick saying, we need to convince them to have a strategy so that that is not, that this climate change is coming about like the many other cycles that we've gone through in this room. We need to be prepared for it because there will be national security implications. Comes from the weather. Even if it's not working, climate change consequences of climate causes. That's the base that we're seeing there. And we do a number of things that make sense anyway for characters and purposes, for second lighting purposes, etc. We may be able to have an effect whether or not there are growth changes or more like anthropogenic worms are going to be substantially higher or take our level. But the fact that we're working with them is a great debate, and obviously, we may not be aware that there are a large number of scientists who suggest that as the Earth changes and goes through the cycle, that's what is producing more CO2. It's not the fact that humans end up producing more CO2 that's creating the climate change. And thus far, what we should be doing is many of the suggestions you make, which are absolutely on target. And I might add, this is my continual conversation with Governor Schwartz in California. Is that there are areas, and large number of areas, for those of us who are skeptical about the human beings of causing global warming, but we should be doing the right thing and making things more efficient and cleaner for that reason. But to try to do this in the name of stopping this climate change is losing, I think, your target that we should be, and in our efforts, realizing that the climate is changing as it has so many times in the past, and prepare for it. In case there are national security implications,
to convince more things for bad reasons or for their reasons or for bad mission their reasons. I'm with the data for scientists who help with the climate change theory to get this. I've been taking these steps for many years, but I really think, speaking for myself and I believe the rest of this committee, we make it very clear that we're not scientists, we're not physicists, so some of them happen to be scientists. One happens to be an astronaut, the other is intimately involved with the nuclear industry. Nuclear power, but as a group, we were not into the data because the data can be contradictory and we're not qualified. What we tried to do is look at the trends and the fact that people saw that from the Atlantic Ocean to the Bering Sea, and they actually had people sailing 35-foot boats down South Circle. Something was going on. I have no idea what it tells us. Is that just as the Vikings were able to do that very same thing, the Earth is going back to a warmer climate just as it was during the Viking period. I don't have any problem with that, but the fact of the matter is, it's worth paying attention to. So, thank you.
We've been joined by Dr. Ryder with my mental subcommittee, but someone from me, this is a subject near and dear to his heart, and in the interest of having the material for my client, especially when I'm talking about the same questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your recognition. I just simply can't make it around something that I have to do something. I can't understand the client, but the many thousands of scientists who say, support this pioneer. I would say there are many more scientists who disagree with that. So it's a preponderance of scientific evidence and scientific belief is on the other side. I normally don't go for arguments,
Questions about the extent to which the changes in the climate, the cost of living, the natural cyclical decline, the extent to which they are caused by human activity, and other issues that you'd like to answer. The questions entirely about it, and again, the scientists should have information from scientists on that. But it's a good understanding of the reasons that the human activity can't affect extent to which the planet may be warming, and therefore, what consequences may result. Mr. Rosen?
Mr. Chairman, I have not one, but two history majors in front of me. I have to be asked, so I would stress that, but I would, I think, basically, that was what I was understanding as a proponent of scientific theories, reflecting on this recent report. Substantial share, possibly around, perhaps less than of the concentration of CO2 that we see in anthropogenic bacteria to have taken off around the beginning of the industrial era a couple of centuries ago. They are approaching double what they have been for extended periods of time. Comes to our laboratory, of course, there have been many periods in the history of the world in which climate is. The correlation seems substantial. Do you think about that? I would say that seriously, what did this in the fact that the building to what they said to him, I would call that directly. But there is an example of the difference in this thing that not so far.
John Salmon, it comes to my ears. The National Security Plan in general doesn't just take into account what is certain to happen in the plan, but given certain amount some uncertainty, what might happen, how likely it is, and we might be prepared for these different events. Is there also part of the military plan and the National Security Plan to see how the likelihood of every event may change by what we do? Mr. Chairman, you're right in both parts. We have looked yet at a number of threats and the likelihood of something happening and try to figure out how we could stop it from happening or do something that might stop it from happening. You could say, no, I have responsibility. And I think that's what's going on in this case. We have cases, though, it's not within the military's program, or the Department of Defense program. The Army actually, and other agencies in the government are involved, and we recognize that.
questions about what can we do about planning and your analysis, so that's that bit, what's going on in the cloud, let's wake up the power of our cloud, just a critical indicator, we try to get more started.
This is sort of like a thing with Ross Director of Central Intelligence, the National Intelligence Council, say that I'm going to make the decision as to the rate of my car that it is
Basically, they don't get the concept. And I hate to think I'm asking the
If you look at some of the areas where we have conflicts, the Korean and if you look at some of the international portions of our countries that we go to work for, regardless of human rights sometimes, and so they have like that from constituents back home. Then you look at Nigeria and elsewhere in the world where our policies might necessarily back the aggressive regimes. But the second question I can have, and others would have to get to both, would be how does our dependence on commercial process back regimes that they lower our international standing or actually may open up any conflict that we might otherwise avoid. But one of our panel members, this is to the leverage question, one of our panel members from Frankfurt Truett, when he and Dr. Lovins have collaborated on a number of issues, and Dr. Lovins showed his name and some of his feelings came up during the study group. Previous study, with our executive director, was participated in emails and programs, so I think his feelings were well known. But the paradox that came up against the camera, they didn't even know the guy's name, or this was the electrical minister for Iraq, so the concepts were inaccurate. Comes with me, I think the motion. Sources on Earth. And I met last week at Carpenter, and looked at
space shuttle in 1973. Very late, if there are no permanent solutions, but it seems to me that the most expedient solution might be looking for domestic sources of oil as well as other energy sources. So in that area, Georgia will have a lot of land that they do not raise to develop energy through wind technology or other things. Some of these other alternative sources of fuel. Don't you think that maybe searching for domestic sources of energy is maybe the best type of policy that we should have today? That's a good point that we make because we have nuclear and it's not going to substitute. As well as looking for domestic sources of petroleum products and maybe new chemical imbalance and so on, make more sense if we can figure out how to create
looking domestically, that's more sense to me than trying to throw the things that maybe not economically feasible. So would you comment about that?
Well, actually, given the science of time,
that's not a plan.
That kind of thing that is a question. You don't have to be a market.
Dispersing carbon dioxide producing materials, which is virtually a quarter of natural gas in the ground plants at this point. The idea is we are going to affect in the grants of Mr. Rosie that the real problem is transportation. And if we do, in fact, go with carbon emissions, we will need considerable amounts of electricity. And I'm pretty sure that they'll be produced by natural plants rather than carbon with natural gas burning plants, particularly since natural gas, in my opinion, is too predictable. That's an incredible feedstock for the petrochemical industry, and it's ideal for sharing those to provide heat for residences. Running an electric power plant, I think, is not an option in this.
Because my sort of bank, the understanding has been pretty clearly in the background, and then what might have been the presentation that you want to have, and how we Pacific Northwest Asian laboratories that were first started in blended hybrids. And let's say that 85% of the crews on the ground could be blended hybrids before they had a single main power plant. Because it is hard to put over to the repair. That's one of the reasons why I shifted from an internal combustion engine to a blended hybrid, even in a cool rate of sets, where the ground starts to run by coal, still saves something on the one of the air solutions in a state like California.
I appreciate your comments about nuclear energy, but I would draw your attention, as this is a general question, but draw your attention of the panel's model to the high temperature gas cooled reactor that is now been designed and prototypes have been built by General Atomics in San Diego, the high temperature gas cooled reactor. From a really number of different reactors, I think the great reactors we have not done adequate research on the many types of reactors. For example, the hydrogen project, which is known to say much about, so that it depends entirely on being able to produce and transport hydrogen at very low cost. From the traditional ways of doing it, not done, but there is perhaps an attempt to introduce our brain as well. The reality is that Mr. Rosie brought up the problems of nuclear waste and also the proliferation issue. And those two issues do not need to prevent us from moving forward with nuclear energy. And I would suggest that Nicola Cowan would like to look at this alternative because if it's a nuclear power plant that cannot, that does not produce waste at the same level, and that it will not produce material that can be turned into bonds. And so it takes care of a lot of problems. And I would hope that you, Mr. Davis, is here with people who respect and pay attention to as well as our panel, would look at this alternative when looking at the issue we're discussing today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I accept your time, Mr. Rafferty. All right. We have time, I think, for one another round of questions. If anyone wants to start the game, and then we do have a few minutes. We probably won't have to carry on with the first couple of minutes of events, but if we could have a quick last round of questions for this distinguished panel, the next panel is also distinguished, and we will
research and development line item that's still in store materials. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
Well, that means that the protection of that and the ability of the three variables which are considered hybrid vehicles. And you can say the aircraft, this new vehicle, which the troops are received, the new vehicle, which is very heavy, because that's what you need to protect the troops.
Mm-hmm.
The most precious asset. But that doesn't mean that the scientists and the people in the labs are working to reduce the weight of the armor which builds the vehicles. And it may be that it's ceramics or some substance which plastics and so forth and so on. So you've got a trade-off, and I'm sure they would work that way for you. The push
is recognized for just documents.
I think it's important for us to know that they were set up exactly right there, and that his job is making sure that our country protecting those people can do their job and defending our country. And while no one disagrees with the fact that we should try and try to develop better, more efficient technologies, the question is
when we have to make decisions right now versus climate change, that we have some effect on climate change, that will in some way prevent the military from doing their job, the generals that are able to do their job. Well, I think that's what happened. I think that's exactly what happened with the Iraq, with the body armor and everything else to protect them. The troops are getting as much what they need. We can't wait for 10 or 20 years. We'll make it happen. And generally, the same principle is true. Unfortunately, we're being told by the alarmists about climate change that we have to have another criteria for how we make our decisions based on concerns like reinvestments. Yes, we should have SUVs that protect our people and our kids and our families, but we should not necessarily mandate it now if the technology isn't ready. And that part of it saying that SUVs are too light or whatever, if that is not ready right now, the alarmist would have us put people in jeopardy. It's as simple as that. And first of all, I appreciate both your testimony today. One discussion. When we look over this report, the government climate change report, what did it say that if we had implemented all of their recommendations and the tremendous cost for the world that we're talking about, what percentage of the climate of the increase in the temperature of the planet
so
close to it. And you don't change it when you're
going to make it. Thank you.
second.